while introducing the bill for consideration. In Madam's opening remarks, I specifically stated that this is a historic bill. As far as trafficking of persons, according to the Madam Minister, and also it has been suggested that it is a comprehensive bill dealing the matter. And also Madam has suggested, or Madam has made a statement in the House, that wider consultation has been done. 60 NGOs were consulted, so many stakeholders were consulted, and even members of parliament were also consulted. So my question through you, sir, is main question is, there is, we are having a parliamentary system of governance in legislation, and there is a particular standing committee is there. As per the procedure as well as the convention of this house, there is a standing committee, concerned standing committee is there. When the government is consulting the NGOs, when the government is consulting the stakeholders and even MPs individually, why the government is hesitating to refer the matter to a standing committee so as to have a closed scrutiny of the entire provisions of the bill? That is the first question which I would like to ask to the Honorable Minister through you, sir, because this is an original bill which is having 58 clauses. It's a big bill, and it's a bill, in one sense it's good, so also I support the bill also. But such a bill having comprehensive legislation in respect of trafficking of persons, and it is a historic bill, it is a new bill, original bill having 58 clauses, and it is being consulted in the public domain, but it is not being consulted in the standing committee, means you are undermining the authority of the parliament standing committee. Why it is not being sent to the parliament standing committee? So my first suggestion to the Honorable Minister through you, sir, the number one is this bill may be sent to the standing committee for having a closed scrutiny of the entire provisions of the bill, number one. And sir, coming to the bill, I do accept trafficking of human beings is one of the largest organized crimes violating the human rights. Sir, to root out and eradicate the human trafficking, definitely I do agree with the Honorable Minister, a comprehensive legislation is absolutely essential and is required. So the first question which I would like to highlight is whether this bill is sufficient to meet the situation. Mr. Chairman, sir, my answer is the bill is neither comprehensive nor clear. That is the first point which I would like to make. Why? What the bill intend to? The bill intend to prevent the trafficking of persons. The bill intend to prosecute offenders, to provide care, protection and rehabilitation to the victims of trafficking. And what are the forms of trafficking as per the bill? Number one, trafficking of persons for sexual exploitation, physical exploitation, and the third one is other forms of exploitation like forced labor and bonded labor. And what the bill provide in order to meet this situation or to arrest the situation or to combat the situation, what the bill provides creates a, according to the Honorable Minister and the statement of objects and reasons of the bill, creates a conducive legal, economic and social environment for the victims of trafficking, and institutional mechanism at district, state and national level for prevention, protection and investigation and rehabilitation, and provides for rehabilitation fund for the welfare of the victims of trafficking. For unfortunately, the fund earmarked in the financial memorandum is just 10 crores of rupees. Just Shashi Tharoor has told the intention and the sincerity of the government is very clear out of it. And the finally, the penal provision thereof who commit or attempt to commit or abate the offences. This is the crux of the bill. Sir, my concerns regarding the bill, number first one is the legislation lacks clarity as there are multiplicity of institutional mechanisms to coordinate various agencies to prevent, investigate, prosecute and provide care and protection. Sir, multiplicity of organization, I may be given little bit time so that I can substantiate the point. It is within the purview of the bill also. The first one is the National Anti-Trafficking Bureau. In clause 3 of the bill, National Anti-Trafficking Bureau, the central government may by notification establish a National Anti-Trafficking Bureau. And clause 3-2, sir, clause 3-2 says that the bearer, clause 3, I may be allowed to quote clause 3-2, the bureau shall have police officers and other officers such as such appropriate rank as may be necessary. It is not clear. The bureau shall have police officers and other officers. Who are the other officers? Of such appropriate rank as may be necessary. This is the National Anti-Trafficking Bureau. And how vague, ambiguous the structure of Anti-Traffic Bureau from this itself is very clear, the ill drafting of the bill. And coming to the functions is explicitly explained in clause 4 of the bill. 25 functions are earmarked. All these functions, if you go to see, if you see, there is no specific function, only general functions of coordination, monitoring, and surveillance. Sir, if you go through the functions of Anti-Trafficking Bureau, 25 in clause 4, ill drafting is evident and repetition. Sir, in these 25 functions also, lot of repetitions are also there. I'm not going to explain. And another officer is state nodal officer, state anti-trafficking committee, full of bureaucrats, state police nodal officer, district anti-trafficking committee, district police nodal officer, anti-trafficking police officer, anti-traffic unit, national anti-traffic relief and rehabilitation committee, full of bureaucrats. Sir, there is no clear distinct responsibility earmarked for each agency except saying the coordination and assisting of all these things. So so my point is, the existing legislations is, there are so many existing legislation already, most of the members have cited, I'm not going to it. But one point I would like to make, sir, there is section 370 to 373 of Indian Penal Code, including section 370A, which was introduced in 2003 pursuant to the recommendation of JS, sir, I will conclude.
Please conclude.
Yes. J.S. Verma committee and taken from the UN protocol to prevent, suppress and punish trafficking of persons, especially women and children. And so many provisions are there. Most of these provisions in the bill is repetition. I will conclude with 2 points with 2 minutes. Sir, what is the logical basis of distinction between simple form of trafficking and aggravated form of trafficking? To me, there is no logical basis. Since there is no time, I cannot substantiate and explain. And finally, the general criticism about the bill, madam, kindly take it in a positive and constructive way. The bill does not speak of a provision where the customer or the client are punished for sex trafficking. Only the party, the victim. Otherwise, as far as the customer or the client is, there is nothing is being speaking about the client or the customer. Sir, I will, with the point, bullet points, I will. And the general criticism of the bill is more crime-centric. Sir, 1 second. Crime-centric than human right-centric. Instead of streamlining the enforcement, the bill sets institutional bureaucracy. Bureaucracy by creating more than 10 agencies. So the bill overemphasizes criminal response and does not give due consideration to the rights and needs of victims and their effective protection and proper rehabilitation. So see, once again, I submit to the Honorable Minister, kindly this bill may be sent to the Standing Committee for having a close scrutiny. With these words, I conclude. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.